Okay, good. Supraja, yes.
Okay, so we are live now.
Start.
Unmute
Yeah.
Supraja. Unmute your mic, please. Supraja, you there?
Hello everyone, good evening in today's webinar session. On behalf of Team EXRX India, myself, Supraja V, I'm an attender actually, I'm a participant, and Rupesh sir from Peak Health Studio, welcome you all. First, I would like to all the co-organizers, Sri Samraj Physiotherapy Center, Tamil Nadu, Sairam Academy, Chennai, and Physioactive Program, Gurugram. I would like to thank Dr. Chandramohan sir, leader of our team, and today's volunteer, Hiral, and all the participants. I welcome today's RP, Dr. Vairav Sudarshan, and request him to start his session. Thank you, sir.
Okay, Sudarshan sir, you can start sharing.
Yeah.
It's visible. Please start the session.
Yeah. So are you able to be the full screen, ma'am?
Yeah, it's full screen only.
Good evening, everybody. So I'm Vairav Sudarshan. I'm a sports physiotherapist. Today, I'm going to share my knowledge about how to manage and assess a condition called osteitis pubis, which is actually common among athletes. So today it's going to be a more of a sport-specific topic. So we'll start with it. So what are we going to cover today? So first, I'm going to tell you what is osteitis pubis and what happens and how it happens, the etiology and the pathophysiology. I'm going to give you a little bit of information about the pathophysiology, what are the biomechanics that happens, and how to assess and confirm whether it is a osteitis pubis and how to manage. The major criteria when it comes to sports is the return to sports. So we will be covering a detailed explanation about return to sports criteria of the after the injury. So what is osteitis pubis? Osteitis pubis is basically an groin injury which happens with an inflammation at the pubic symphysis. So what happens? Like it mostly happens with elite athletes, especially sports involving kicking. It is a degenerative process which involves the pubic symphysis and the surrounding tendons. So it not only affects the pubic symphysis, also the muscles surrounding the pubic symphysis and the causing the movements and stabilizing the joints around the pelvis. So the changes at the symphysis may be asymptomatic, but the athletes often present a symptom of slow recovery and high recurrence rate. As it is an inflammatory condition at the pubic symphysis, so that progression at that point is going to be delayed. So it usually this type of this injury will take a player to come back easily for 10 to 12 months of average. So because it is a long, prolonged injury which happens at that point, because if it is a muscular injury, there'll be enough blood supply or nutrition towards that particular injury site. But in this case, it is a bone and the tendon which is being involved, so that the injury recovery rate will be little slow. And if it is not treated well, or if it is not diagnosed well, in cases of early sports activities being given for them, without any proper diagnosis or rehab, then the recurrence rate is very high at this condition, because it doesn't, as I told you, it is going to take a very long time to recover. So if you misdiagnose or if you miscalculate even a single region and ask him to go for a sport in advance, then the recurrence rate is going to be high. And it also occurs in athletes involving track and field sports. So track and field sports, for example, you can say athletics, for example, 100 meters runners, running sprint, 200 meters, like that, running activities and field sports. Field sports has, there is, field sport is a big umbrella term where you have sports such as basketball, volleyball, and your football, cricket, hockey. There are n number of sports which comes under field sports. It also occurs in non-athletes. So like mostly in non-athletes, today we are not going to talk much about the non-athletes as it is, as the topic is being more sports specific, you're not going to talk more about the non-athletes. But this also occurs in non-athletes after women's, for women after pregnancy or any postpartum diseases and or of the symphysis or traumatic injury related to pelvic. So now coming to the anatomy. So there are every joint has ligaments to stabilize the stabilize it. So as of coming to the symphysis pubis, there are majorly three ligaments: superior pubic ligament and inferior pubic ligament and intrapubic disc, which actually separates both the pubic bone. So this is the basic structure of the pelvis. So where you have the pubic tubercle here and the pectineal line over here, then this is the pubic symphysis, which is the joint between the two pubic bone. Then you have the ischial ramus, and this one in the center, which is like this one here, is the inferior pubic ligament, and this one is the superior pubic ligament. This is the pubic crest, and this is the obturator foramen. So coming to the range of motion, so there was a study which was done with 4 cadavers and 15 healthy volunteers, where they found to have a movement which has been analyzed at the pelvis. So where they found that they had a vertical translation average around 2.5 millimeters, and transverse and a sagittal translation were less than 1 millimeter. Rotational in the frontal and sagittal plane were found to be less than 1 millimeter, with rotation up to 3 degrees. So there was no significant difference between male and female except pregnant women, which they found it to be more mobile. So these are the muscles surrounding the pelvis. So here, this is the iliacus and the psoas major, which together called as the hip flexors. And you have the piriformis, you have the pectineus. Then you have the adducta muscles, that is adducta brevis, longus, magnus, and gracilis. You have the tensor fasciae lata. Then comes the iliotibial band. So we'll just have a brief recollect. We'll just recollect briefly about the anatomy. So first thing, we'll start off with the adducta brevis. Adducta brevis muscle originates from inferior pubic ramus, gets inserted in the medial ridge of the linea aspera. Then the longus muscle, front side of the pubic bone under the pubic tubercle, then goes on to the middle ridge of the linea aspera. Then you have the adducta magnus, starts from the inferior pubic rami and ischial tuberosity, then goes on and attaches to the middle ridge of the linea aspera and the adducta tubercle. Next, we have the adducta minimus. Adducta minimus muscle originates from inferior pubic rami and gets inserted into the medial ridge of the linea aspera. The next one is the pectineus. Then pectineus muscle starts from the pectineal line and gets attached to the other pectineal line. Gracilis, which actually originates from the inferior pubic ramus, then goes attached to the pes anserinus tendon on the tibia, so which is a bijoint muscle. Then you have the obturator externus, lateral surface of the obturator membrane, and the ischiopubic ramus. It originates from that point and goes on to the prokatic fossa. So coming to the etiology, what all are the causes for this injury? So doing exercises on the hard surface or any irregular surface is one reason. Exercises on uneven ground, as I told you, then beginning an exercises program after a long day off period. So as I told you, overtraining, inappropriate training will also cause this injury. So for example, if you're going to start, if you've been doing regular exercises for 3 or 6 months and you suddenly have a break for a month, then come back to the if you're planning to start your exercises again on that time, you have to start slowly. So you are not supposed to go on to the same regime that you have been following before your break. If you start like that, then this will also cause your injury. Increasing exercise intensity or duration too quickly, if the muscle is not fit to progress, or if it is not ready, or if it is not strengthened properly, and if you immediately go on for the second regime on the higher level of set of exercises, then it will be one of the reasons. Then exercises on worn out or ill-fitting shoes. Your footwear will also give you, is one of the major factor that you have to consider, because that helps you stabilize and gives you the base of support, or gives you the support while running or doing any activities. If the shoes is not fit, if you are wearing tight shoes, or if you are wearing worn out shoes, so that the balance will not be there properly. So there will be an imbalanced muscle loading because of that. So this is one major research area where every shoe company or any footwear company will be doing a proper research on every footwear that they manufacture. So that is one of the major reason for that. And biomechanical influences, coming on to the biomechanics. So now faulty foot or biomechanical changes in the gait. So there, so these are all factors will lead to this. So as I told you, overtraining or any improper training will lead to biomechanical defaults. So like if you're this one, if you consider the faulty foot and body biomechanics and gait disturbances will be caused, one of the reason, if you do a regular exercises on uneven surface or uneven ground, hard surface, or with using your improper footwear, will lead to this. So poor running technique and walking mechanism, and tight and stiff muscle of the hip, groin, and the gluteal region, and muscular imbalances and leg length differences. So these are all the biomechanical factors. So where if these small biomechanical changes will overload that particular muscle or that region or that bone or the joint to cause an injury. So what are the stages? Every injury has some classifications and stages of injury, so that you need to assess and document it according to the stages of injury. You have to document it, and you need to plan a proper management for that particular particular injury. And you need to give them a proper time frame for the recovery. So stages are one of the most important thing that we need to know. So you need to assess the stages, and you have to know the stages. Okay. So stage one, usually in stage one, you have unilateral dominant. So unilateral involvement. So unilateral involvement is, it's going to be one leg or one side, which is mostly the dominant side will be affected. Site of pain, there'll be complaining pain at the inguinal region with the radiation towards the adductors, that is towards your groin. Then the characteristic of pain will be the mechanical. It will, the pain will settle after warm up, and the pain will come back after training or after cool down. Stage three, it is bilateral. Same place, you'll be feeling the pain at the inguinal area and the adductor region. The characteristic of pain is going to be the same mechanical pain. It is going to increase after the training. Even after cool down, you might not be able to feel the reduction of pain. When coming to stage three, it is bilateral. So you will feel, you'll have more number of places where you can site the pain. For example, groin, adductor region, suprapubic region, and the abdominal area will also have pain. So what are the characteristics? So when do you feel the pain? During training, kicking, sprinting, turning, obstruct them to achieve their training goals, and they'll also be forced to withdraw from the sport or the training. Stage four, this is generalized. So it is a worst condition where it is very hard to very difficult to diagnose at this point of stage, because they'll be having a generalized pain, radiation towards the lumbar region also as well. They'll even feel pain while walking getting up, even during straining at stools, simple activities of daily living will also be affected for them. So coming to the examination part, how do you diagnose? How do you find out it is osteitis pubis? So as I told you, there are many different differential diagnoses are there in this area. So comparing to abdomen, you have many differential diagnoses, which I'll be telling you in the further coming slide. So we need to be precise. We need to know that this is the condition that the player has been affected, or this is the condition that has been affecting the player from who is not able to perform. So we need to make sure that this is, so make sure what is happening to them. So the examination is one main key which helps us to find and be precise about the diagnosis. First simple test is pubic sprinting test, spring test. So examiner places a simultaneous downward pressure on the pubic rami with his hands. So positive finding, how do you find? The pain will be reported at the pubic symphysis. The site of pain, the site of injury, or the site of inflammation is the pubic symphysis. So you will be having the pain around the region during the palpation. This is a simple palpation test. Next, coming to the lateral compression test. So patient is in a lateral decubitus position. So this position is like you have to go on the sideline, sideline position, where you're, if you're going on to the left side lying, your right side leg will be flexed and placed. With this position, the pressure will be loaded on the supra-iliac vein, where the pain will be reported at the pubic symphysis. Next, everybody will be knowing about the Faber's test. When during the Faber's test, if they feel the pain at the pubic symphysis, it is one of the diagnoses to confirm that it is an osteitis pubis. Then the basic test is the isometric test, which is the adductor squeeze test. We'll ask the patient to go on a crook lying, knee flexed, and the examiner will have to place the fist between both the knees and ask them to squeeze. So when the player or the patient is squeezing your fist, there will be a pain reported at the pubic symphysis. So next one, the basic radiological finding that you can see is a X-ray. So even in X-ray, you'll be able to see, as it is a bony degenerative condition, so you'll be able to see in the X-ray. So where you'll be able to see a subchondral erosion and joint irregularity, the joint will be misaligned, where there will be upslip and downslip can be will be formed. And there will be a sclerosis around the pubic symphysis. Next, coming to the MRI. So MRI is the next stage. MRI and the CT is the next stage of the X-ray. So where if it is a stage one or a stage through stage two, you'll not be, you know, a few times you'll not be able to diagnose with an X-ray. So you need to go on with a further investigation. Then we can refer a player to go on for a MRI or a CT. Sir, here in a CT MRI, you'll be able to see this is the pubic symphysis. The same malalignment has been found, and there is inflammation surrounding the pubic symphysis. In CT, these are the bony areas where the same, you'll be able to see the degeneration around the pubic symphysis, and there is a malalignment. So next one is the core stability. So you need to assess the core. So basic, any injury or any strain related to the abdomen, you start out with the core stability. So that if you are going to start with the core stability, you need to know where the player is. So how the player is, how the strength of the core is, how the strength of the muscle is. So for example, if you're going to do a biceps strength test, you can go on with 1 RM or various strength guidelines are there to assess their strength. And for coming to core, this is one of the core stability test where they have 5 levels of strengthening. So level 1 level 2 level 3. So level 1 is begin with supine crook lying position while the abdomen is hollowed. Slowly raise one leg to 100 degree of hip flexion and comfortable knee flexion. opposite leg brought to the same position. So in this position, if he is able to do, then he is level one. Then the level two is hip flex position, slowly the leg, one leg, lower the one leg until the heel gets contact to the ground, slide out the leg, fully extend the knee and return to the starting position. So if he is able to complete without any discomforts, if he is able to complete with proper gentle movements without any difficulty, then he clears the grade two. Then coming to the grade three, hip, from the hip flex position, slowly lower one leg until the heel is 12 centimeters above the ground and slide out the leg to fully extend the knee and return to the starting position. So this is level three. Then coming to the level four, from the hip flex position, slowly lower both the legs until the heel gets contact to the ground and slide out the legs to fully extend the knees and return back to the starting position. Then the fifth level is hip, from the starting position, you need to go lower both the legs until the heel is 12 centimeters above the ground. Slide your legs and fully extend the knees and get back to the starting position. This is one basic test to assess the core, assess the core strength. You can also, there are various tests. This is one test that you can use for analyzing the core stability. So coming to the differential diagnosis, what are the differential diagnoses that can be formed? So other than osteitis pubis, you can go on with pubic osteomyelitis, adductor tendinopathy, sports hernia, Gilmour's groin, hockey player syndrome, stress fracture, avulsion fracture, iliopsoas bursitis, sacroiliac dysfunction, hip pathology, labral tears, snapping off hip, femoroacetabular ligament impingement, loose bodies, etc. And referred lower back pain, nerve compression, and genital urinary system disorders. Coming to the management, what are you going to do? How are you going to manage? What are the things can be done to manage the pain and the muscle imbalances and the core stability? All the management comes from. So first of all, you're going to manage every basic injury or every basic complaints. You have to start managing with the pain. So you have to start with the pain management. I'll be telling you about the pain management in the upcoming slide. But other than that, we have to concentrate on spinal and the pelvic alignment work. Muscle energy technique to activate the muscles, and soft tissue work and stretching. Soft tissue work is like the muscle myofascial release and trigger point release, or various techniques are there. You can use any of your comfortable techniques to work on that until the player or the client who is coming to you is getting a proper progression. Anything is fine. And lower limb and core strengthening exercises. And also, if there is any limb length discrepancy, you need to work on the footwear. So, and also check with the biomechanical analysis. So, biomechanical analysis, the same way, you need to assess the player's posture, and you need to assess how the player is walking and running, and you need to retrain it or correct it if it is wrong. And you need to also concentrate on technical skills. So, for example, if he is a cricket player or a fast bowler, you need to make sure that he is able to bowl how he was before the injury, or you need to make him bowl better than how he was. Then you can give him some balance exercises, retraining or balance training. Then you can go on with some home exercise program. You have to, as it is abdominal region area, so you need to work on the breathing as well. So you have to concentrate breathing training as well. So electrotherapy, you can use ultrasound. So local injection, there are various local injections such as corticosteroids and PRP injections that been used. But as far as considered to this condition, the local injections has not been given a proper feedback. It's like it is not proven that it gives a proper result to the players. Even after one, for example, there are various studies which shows that even after one shot of corticosteroids, the player is not able to get back to his actual or a normal state. So they had to come back to the doctor, and they had to take another shot of corticosteroids or increase the dosage according to the pain. So this injections or the local these local injections are not one of the best thing to be given to the this particular injury. Apart from that, if you have any other joint issues, there are very major supporting articles, or even I have seen a lot of differences in players who has some ACL injury, ankle ligament tears, shoulder labrum tear also. They have been injected with local injections, and they have been performing very well. But in this case, this is not given a better result. So coming to the physio part, rehab is the main thing that a physio can be master of. So we can give we have to plan a proper rehab and proper schedule to that particular player or the client to get back out of the injury. So rehab plays a major role here. So whatever the management that you'll be doing, myofascial release, dry needling, cupping therapy, anything that you can use, but exercise is one of the main thing that gives you the permanent solution for any injury. So exercises are the main key. So you need to concentrate, or you need to formulate a proper exercise schedule for that particular player, so that he comes out of that injury permanently. So if the treatment is not completed, if your program is not completed, if he goes back to the game, and he might have recurrence. So to prevent that, you need to give him a proper set of rehab. So you need to plan proper how it goes. So start from the basic. First, you need to start with isometric exercises. So after managing the pain, you need to go on with isometric exercises, then concentric, then coming to the eccentric loading. So this way, isometric is a phase where we can give the, for example, we'll consider it as a stage one rehab. So isometric phase where we ask them to go for a basic muscle activation. So during pain, if he is not able to move properly, if the concentric exercises he is not able to do, for instance, it is a grade two or a grade three, he has to maintain this muscle properties. So we need to start giving them isometric exercises so that the muscle property is being maintained properly, so that he'll be able to get an early recovery. And the next, coming to the concentric, where you are, when the isometric exercises are being given perfectly, if all the exercises are being given perfectly and he is being able to do all the basic exercises without pain, then you need to strengthen the muscle concentrically. Concentrically, if you strengthen, it gives a next level of strengthening to that muscle. So you can, he'll be able to build, you'll have to assess the which muscle is being you have to assess the muscle imbalance. You need to know the muscle tightness. So you need to assess the muscle tightness as well. I forgot to mention about that. So you need to also assess the muscle tightness. The muscle length has to be assessed. And the joint range, for a basic identification of the muscle length, you can assess the joint range of that hip muscle. So you will not be able to assess the range of pubic symphysis. So you will have to use a hip muscle, hip joint range of motion will help you to analyze how the muscle length is. If the range is restricted, if one particular muscle is being restricted, then that particular movement which involves that muscle will be causing pain. So the range will be restricted. So less range of motion will be there. So you need to work on the joint, you'll have to work on the muscle length as well as the joint mobility. Then coming to the eccentric loading. Eccentric loading is the final stage of rehab, where if you're going to progress a player to the eccentric training, he has to complete the isometric training perfectly and concentric training perfectly, then only he'll be able to train the eccentric. Because it is an explosive training where you'll have to have a proper strength to do all those workouts. So for example, plyometric. It is an explosive workout. So you need to have concentric and eccentric muscle strength. And if it is balanced, then we can progress to eccentric. So coming to the stage one, the pain protocol. So what we can do for controlling the pain? In this stage, the patient will be in rest for 3 to 4 weeks. So he'll be having pain. He'll not be able to do any movement. He'll be given rest or been sent home from the game or the sport to take rest so that he'll be able to recover fully. During that time, you can we'll initially ask them to take a rest for 3 to 4 weeks. They'll undergo RICE protocol, so where they can go for icing and alternate contrast bath or contrast hot and cold application can be given. And controlled exercises program can be scheduled and can be prescribed for them. One of the major things is the hydrotherapy, where we can ask them to go inside the swimming pool and ask them to go do a very basic exercises. So for first starting thing, we can ask them to do a normal range of motion. For example, ask them to stand with support and ask them to do a hip flexion extension, abduction, adduction, rotation. All these movements we can ask him to do. If he is comfortable, then we can ask him to do squats, lunge. You can also ask him to do a bit of stretching inside the swimming pool with the control stretching, where all these things where you can go as it is a pain control protocol. We need to know the pain, and we need to know if he's having any pain with doing any particular exercise or any particular stretch. We need to know, we need to get the feedback, and we need to document it every single day and every week. We need to know what is the progression, so that you need to, we can just alter the exercises or the stretch that is being advised to. So together we can also ask him to go for a deep muscle massage. So massages also can be given, but you have to make sure that massage does not disturb the inflammation. So yeah, you have to instruct to the masseur that not to disturb that particular region where his involvement is. Then, as I told you, we have to start with the basic static isometric strength exercises on the pelvic floor. Then where we can activate your transverse abdominis, multifidus, diaphragm, and the adductors and the abdominal wall muscles. Also, we can also, as I told you, we can also go on with basic concentric exercises without resistance for those muscle group which will help you to recover faster. Or you have to monitor which muscles can be easily loaded without pain. Or if he is able to do a particular movement without pain, we can go on with the concentric exercises with that muscle. So then. Gentle stretch. So gentle stretch, as I told you, he's not allowed to stretch completely. So he'll have to do a stretch with the he'll have to do a basic stretch or a moderate stretch, or he can reduce the range of motion or reduce the range of stretch so that he's feeling comfortable during the stretch. So and you can also advise him to go for cycling including the cardiovascular training. Then we have to start balance training. For example, we can go on with basic balance training, starts with a single leg stance, eyes open, so that we can also train the balance. Stage two is like we can go on with Swiss ball workouts, so where we can reduce the base of support. Other than the concentric muscle workouts, we'll also have to work on the balance. So we'll have to end the pelvic tilt. So we'll also have to work on the pelvic tilt so that we can ask him to go on a balance training or a pelvic tilt on the Swiss ball. So ask him to sit and perform a pelvic tilt so that he's able to do all the muscles, all the actions perfectly. So. And you can also add resistance to the workout. Like for example, if he's going to do a hip bridge, so you can also ask him to go with resistant bands, or you can also have a co-contraction exercises by activating the adductors and the pelvic floor together. And you also have to concentrate on the gluteal strength by increasing the duration of cycling by asking him to do for 20 minutes per day. Change the speed and the resistance can be done dynamic strengthening of the muscles around the hip, hip in the flexion, extension, abduction, adduction, all the planes can be given using the elastic band or the TheraBand. So primary objective of us to is to achieve grade 3 in USB rope lumbar pelvic stability. So I'll be explaining what all the what is USB pelvic stability protocol, and in also it, in which he'll be able, he has to do without the symptoms, and he has to do a maximum of 30 minutes program altering fast walk, running and walking. So all these activities should not have any pain. So you need to monitor all those things and perform. If he is, for instance, if he is having pain, then you need to avoid those particular exercises or a stretch and come back to that basic routine that is being followed, prolong for some time, ask him to do the basic regime for some more time, and see if it is progressing, then you have to go to the stage 2 or stage 3. So coming to that protocol, there are basically three exercises that they use for assessment. One is a single leg, then is a dip test, then is a runner's pose test. So there are various ways they analyze. So like overall they analyze the weight transfer, they analyze the lumbar spine and the pelvic alignment, they analyze the leg alignment and the foot alignment. So they differentiate into good and poor. First I'll go on with overall impression. So you'll be asked to perform a single leg squat without support, in which you'll have to do, if he is good, he'll be able to do a smooth and a good quality movement and a general control. So and also there'll be controlled between the repetition and the leg. If he's going to do 5 reps or 6 reps, if he's going to do 5 reps continuously, he'll be able to do a controlled movements in every repetition. If it is poor, then there will be a difference in movement. There will be increased speed to compensate. So, compensation will be there so that he'll be increasing the speed to control the movement. He'll be putting too much effort to control the movement as well. So he'll be having a lot of balance issues, so that he'll have to put too much effort. He'll be using the accessory muscles and he'll be using the accessory muscle to control it. So there'll be a trunk which will be wobbling around every movement or every set. Now coming to the weight transfer. The minimal translation of the center of mass operate to the trunk. The center of gravity or the center of mass will be perfect. So he'll be able to, because this is the reason, if the center of gravity and the center of mass is right, he'll be able to perform smoothly. Same way, if it is poor, there'll be a transition in center of mass. The center of mass will be keep moving here and there. The trunk will be leaning side to side. There'll be extension times to transfer the load. He'll be having balance. So he'll have to balance in a single leg, right? So he'll be compensating. He'll be, as I told you, he'll be using the accessory muscle to make sure that he's putting too much effort to control the movement. Then lumbar spine and the pelvic alignment. So there'll be, if it is good, there will be minimal movement in the in all three planes. For example, you'll have to assess in the frontal plane, you have to assess the ASIS level, then the sagittal plane, the minimal AP tilt and rotation you have to assess, so you have to view, and lateral view, you have to see there is a stable lordosis and minimal trunk flexion. And when it is poor, same way, he'll be tilting here and there. There'll be rotation found in, to compensate the weight bearing in single leg. He'll be having an abnormal tilt of anterior or in posterior direction. There'll be increasing in the lumbar lordosis and trunk flexion, which is occurring to compensate or to maintain the balance. Leg alignment. When it is coming to the leg alignment, there will be a minimal movement out at the starting plane of the movement. This will be taken into the account of the alignment of the leg. So he'll be able to stand stably, and the this will be less. There will be less influence of this in the pelvic width and the Q angle of the knee. When it is in, if he is poor, the movement will be very abnormal. He'll be changing the planes here and there, and there'll be a compensation of movements if he's poor. And the foot alignment. The foot alignment, if it is normal, it will be you will be having a few neutral foot alignment, remains stable, and he'll not be moving the foot. So he'll be stable throughout the movement. And if it is a poor movement, poor state, he'll be having excessive pronation of the foot during the squat descent, and external rotation in the starting position of the lower leg or the foot will be seen. Next one is the dip test. So we'll be asking to, this will be the starting position of the player, and we'll ask him to do a dip movement. So where, same thing. So overall movement, it has to be smooth, controlled, and there should be no changes between the repetition. Same way, the load will be monitored. If it is abnormal load, controlling the movement to by increasing the speed. There'll be a lot of effort to control the movement, same as the previous test. And same way, the minimal weight bearing at the back leg, if it is weight distribution, and the back leg remains oriented at the sagittal plane, there'll be no movement in the frontal plane, upright trunk. Excessive weight on the back, if it is poor, he'll be having excessive weight on the back leg. So here, this means he has to put the full load on the front leg. There'll be abduction of the back leg. The trunk will be leaning forward or side to side. When coming to the lumbar alignment, minimal movement on all three planes. And same way, there'll be a lot of trunk rotation and flexion. If he is poor, leg alignment, same way you'll be having minimal movement, and it takes same way the unit assesses the Q angle and the pelvic influence. Same as the previous test, you need to assess all the poor and good criteria. Same foot placement has to be maintained. So next one is the runner's pose test. Overall impression, it has to be good, smooth. And the controlled movement should be there. If it is poor, the movement will be jerky movement will be found. Effort will be too much to control the movement. Excessive trunk movement will be seen. Weight distribution, there will be a minimal weight distribution of the center of mass if he is good. If he is poor, inability to maintain the center of mass and weight bearing leg. Pelvic alignment, same way, all three pelvic movement will be analyzed. Then if it is abnormal, same way, the disorientation will be there in the pelvic tilt in frontal plane. Trunk alignment, no trunk rotation of the trunk, upright trunk will be there. If it is poor, then the trunk rotation and the forward flexion of the trunk and the trunk trunk will be locked in extension. See, this will be, this three test, you'll not be able to view accurately or assess accurately with the naked eye. So what you can do is just record it on a phone, record it with a camera, and view it in a slow motion or control movement in your bigger screen. And this will help you to do a better assessment. So now coming to the stage two, which is the eccentric workout. Stage three, which is the eccentric workout. So as I told you, eccentric work on the sliding board. There is a board which will be there'll be a less friction will be there on that board. You can ask them to stand and ask them to go for a abduction of the hip in standing position, and ask them to do a slide abduction or flexion extension. Can be done on the sliding board, where the initial movement should not go more than 1 meter on the lateral slide. So if you're going on the lateral slide, you're not supposed to go more than 1 meter. Initially, 1 meter can be advised for them. You can ask them to go for 3 sets and 30 seconds of each sets. So progressively, you can increase the terms of the distance of this. So 1 meter can go up to 1.5, then it can go up to 2. Like that, you can slowly increase if he is comfortable, and the number of sets can be increased. So running time. So as I told you, workload management, we'll discuss it in the upcoming slides. So workload management, you need to manage the workload by giving the particular workout gradually. You need to increase the load gradually, and change of pace or the direction can be introduced. And to reproduce the sports requirements, the athlete will start training with the field. So like we can ask him to go to the ground. If he is a sprinter, you can go ask him to go onto the ground and start doing his sports routines. Using indoor circuit training can be given, and performing exercises to mimic the sport. For example, if he is a runner, we can do some exercises that will actually mimic his sport. For example, you can ask him to do a mountain climbers, which actually is exercises for core, which goes on with the repetitive movement of the hip flexion and extension and the knee. So same way, you can ask him to go perform that kind of exercise. For example, if he is a bowler, you can ask him to go fast bowler, ask him to go for a trunk rotation with arms extended, theraband can be given with the resistance. Ask him to go for trunk flexion. Ask him to go there sports specific movement. The bowling action, like that, we can schedule few exercises or drills so that their sports so that the muscle memory is being retained. As I told you, it is a long injury. It's going to take at least a year for a player to come back to the sport. So in that case, you need to make the it is also important that you need to maintain the muscle memory so that once he is getting back to the field, he'll be able to get back to the sport easily and the progression will be easy. So the kicking is allowed only at, as I told you, if he is a football player, you can start with kicking. So kicking is allowed only at the end stage. So eccentric abdominal wall strengthening can start. So these are all like, you have to stabilize the pelvis. You need to work on the hip, adductors and the knee. You need to work on the spine. All these stability and the mobility workout will make him better. So the next one is like, you have to make sure that he passes the grade 4 of the lumbopelvic stability grade. And then at this stage, the athlete will start progressing to the squat training. And at this stage, they can progressively practice the sport. So like you'll have to ask him to go for that particular sport. You can ask him to go for bowling if he's a bowler. If he's a batsman, you can ask him to go for batting training. So like that, like slowly, you can, for example, if he's a bowler, you can ask him to go for spot bowling. And if he's a batsman, you can ask him to go for basic drills like there are many drills that they go for every shot. They perform drills with a plastic ball or using a sidearm thrower. So you can ask them to go with those drills for them, and so that they'll be able to see whether they are able to do easy movement without pain. And you can also ask them to go for some practice. Like if he's comfortable with all these practice sessions and squat training, we can ask him to go for some practice matches. Like you can ask him to go for if there is a tournament happening, there is a small practice match will be there before the game. So you can ask them to go for that practice matches and see how he is playing, how he is doing during a course of the game. So like that, you can progress. So the clinical guidelines. So 1 month, he has to be symptom free. So we can assess it by negative squeeze test. Next one is a pain-free palpation of the pubic symphysis and the pubic rami. Next one, pain-free stretching and isometric and concentric exercises, concentric and eccentric exercises of the adductors. And negative osteopathic assessment. There should be no any osteopathic abnormalities such as structural and functional movement should not be abnormal. So if he's able to manage the core strength to level 4 or level 5, he'll be able to go back to the game. If he's able to do concentric eccentric work together, as I told you, co-contraction workouts, if he's able to do for the rectus abdominis and both obliques will with 7 sets of 7 repetitions of 3 sets a week will make will two sets of sand repetitions a week can help him to go make sure that he's not having any pain during those tests. If he's completely better, you can progress him to the next level. So coming to the fitness criteria, so for example, if he's a runner or if he's a field sport, for example, football, hockey, or a cricketer, you can ask him to go for a achievements. You can collect the achievements that he has done to the previous injuries, or if he has done any specific test for prior the injury, and we can take that record into consideration and make him to go for that test. So for example, in recent tense, people are going on to yo-yo test. So yo-yo test is one of the major fitness criteria that they take. So they make them to go for yo-yo test. For in case of, if you want to go, and that is used for that is used to assess the cardiovascular endurance of the agility. If you want to assess the specific agility test, you can go on with T-run or agility shuttle run, or there are various fitness tests can be done for that particular running test, so that you can 100 meter sprint, 200 meter, 50 meters, like that. You can ask them to perform that test, document it, and compare it with the previous test that is done before the injury. If he is able to run 20 minutes at three different intensities, is good. Then comparing the full squat training sessions without any problem. So 2 weeks of training, stages of 3 to 4 is very good. And completing a full game. So as I told you, if he's going to play a practice game or a friendly match which is happening between two teams, so you can make him to play for that game and see how he's progressing. If he's coming back to you after the game without any symptoms, he's okay. So this, now coming to the rehab part. So this is one basic stage one rehab protocol. So where we can go on with TA activation, glute bridge, plank, side plank, SLR, adductor squeeze, and adductor squeeze. If he's having a positive squeeze test, you need to avoid that. Then glute squeeze, squat hold, cycling, hydrotherapy, isometric hams curls for the hams and quads, single leg stance to improve the balance. This is one basic exercise regime, and you can ask the exercise schedule has to be tailor made. So it has to be specific for that player. So one player with the same injury will be having different symptoms or different stage. You need to make sure that you have to formulate a exercise protocol according to his assessment, according to his reports. Same way, a different player coming to a less intensity of pain, less symptoms compared to the other player, you can prescribe him a different set of exercises and different set of workouts for him. So you need to, you have to assess. According to the assessment, you can go on with the exercise protocol. So I'm giving you a basic idea how to formulate it, okay? So then you can go on with stretches with hip flexors, piriformis, glutes, quadratus lumborum, hamstring, calf, and spinal muscles. Spinal muscle, for example, you can start out with lumbar stretch. Stage 2. So you need to concentrate on your hip flexors, groin, glutes, and your spinal muscles. So, and your abdominal muscles as well. So this is one particular protocol for, the first line is one particular protocol for hip flexor. This one is a basic crook line, performing a knee flexion extension, sorry, hip flexion extension. So this is a starting position. You have to start off with the 90-90 position on line where your pelvic has to be neutral. You have to activate your transverse abdominis so that the pelvic is in neutral position. Then you need to perform flexion extension alternatively in each leg for this exercise. So this one is you need to make sure that he has to have a proper breath control, so that for this reason, as you're going to train the core, you need to make sure that the breathing patterns are right. That's why we are asking them to go for a proper breathing technique in the initial stage itself. So Then coming to the stage two, single leg hip flexor extension, where you can go on with the, this is a starting position. So where the other leg is being placed in flexion position. And next one is you need to perform a hip flexion extension with a resistance band. And same way, this exercise, the first exercise also, you can tie a resistance band on the toe, on both of your toes, or a loop band on your toes, and perform this exercise. So like this. So the next one is you can ask them to go. This is the, you have to progress the exercise. You need to improve the core. You need to push the core to its limit. So you need to progress it. You need to show difference so that you will be able to strengthen it at the best level. So that what you, this is a type of a co-contraction. So you'll be activating the glutes, transverse abdominis, multifidus, everything. Every core muscle will be activated, and your hamstring will be activated. And with the, in this position, so like you can ask him to go on placing his heel on the on a board or a bench or a chair, if it, whatever it is available, you can use that material. And ask him to perform hip flexion extension, which is the hip flexor movement, and strengthen the hip flexors. And you can also increase the complexity of this muscle by asking him to place this knee on a Swiss ball. So next one, coming to the glute muscle, so like the adductor muscle, sorry. So the basic adductor squeeze with the Swiss ball or a medicine ball or a soft ball between the knees, ask him to go. Same way, first ask him to perform this exercise on crooked line. If he is comfortable and if he is able to do it freely, then you can ask him to go on a 90-90 position and the core activation, then ask him to squeeze. Okay, same way you can also ask him to do. So as you're doing adduction, same way you can, we can also ask him to do an abduction movement using a resistant loop band. Same, you can also start with adductor movements like on a plank position. So or a standing position, we can use a resistant band or a power band. You can ask him to do the same workout in standing position. The lying position is a complex, like the second level of thing, which that is from the standing position. If he is able to go comfortably, you can progress to this exercise, this workout. So if in this lying position, you'll be able to activate the internal external obliques, your core and the abdominal muscles, and you can perform the abduction reduction movement. You can also use ankle weights for performing these exercises if he's if he is able to do this workout easily. Same way, as I told you, you need to increase the complexity. You need to increase load on that. Next one is the stretching of the groin. So this one is a rocking groin stretch, which we have to slowly, we have to adapt this chain pose, and you have to go rock forward and backward slowly so that the hip mobility is also being maintained. The next one is a 90-90 stretch, where you can ask him to go on a 90-90 sitting position, and with both the knees flexed, you can start. Then you can slowly extend the knee and to maintain the stretch. Next one, in different position, you need to load the joint and mobilize the joint. So this one is in the squat position. So ask him to go for a deep squat and perform internal and external rotation of the hip. Then you can ask the person to go on supine lying and ask him to perform a hip internal rotation, external rotation on supine lying. Also, you can ask him to go for prone lying and perform internal external rotation. Same way, you can add load by using a TheraBand or ankle weights. You can also increase the load of this workout by increasing the resistance. So next one is the reverse clamshells. So this one, this exercise is the clamshell is the basic abduction movement of the hip. So if you're going to do the opposite rotation of the hip, then you need to do a reverse clamshell to activate this muscle. So you can also use an ankle weight to increase the resistance. This one is one of the finest adductor program, which is being used in football, used for football players commonly. So as football is one of the, as I told you, it is one of the field games where there will be a lot of running and kicking involved. So this is one of the exercises that can be given. So as I told you, in this question, so you can ask him to do abduction, adduction. Same way, you can ask the help of a player, or you can hold the knee and stabilize it. Stabilize the opposite knee. See, in this second and the third picture, this player, the player holding the knee is like, in this position, he is little diagonal, but he is parallel to the knee. So you can ask him to go diagonal in the stage one, stage two, and ask him to perform abduction, adduction. And if in stage three, he can stand parallel and do abduction, adduction movement. If anyone is not available, you can use a bench and support, and bench for a support, and you can perform this exercise. Same way, if he is able to do freely, you can also use a ankle weight for this exercise. So then we have the common exercise called the sumo squats, which activates your adductors. Very good. So you can, same way, you can also add resistance by giving them a kettlebell or a dumbbell, or they can also use a barbell with weights for resistance. So the stage three is a plyometric workout. So plyometric is an explosive workout or eccentric type of workouts, which help them to perform better. So like the plyometric is like explosive. They are not going to do a smooth movement in their sport. They need to know how the muscles are working explosively. So you need to train the explosive movements as well. So if he is a basketball player, jumping is one of the major basketball or volleyball. He has to jump and land and see how it is. So you need to train all those factors as well. So this is one. So jumping on the board, stepper board, and jump squats, and on the stepper board, on the floor. So jump squat and plank, or squat, plank, and you can do a push-up. You can actually ask them to do burpees. Then side-to-side jumps, lateral jumps. So where you can go on with the progression. Then high knees. Then single leg high knees, where we can go on, ask him to go on a single leg deadlift position, and ask him to go for high knees. Then you can ask him to go for a core activation, and ask him to go for a plyo push-up. Then you can slowly progress, then goes on to the progressive resisted exercises. So progressive resisted exercise. So you need to see. So you need to see whether he is able to do all the exercises completely without resistance. If he's free, he's completely better, or without any pain, he's able to do all those. And then you can go on with the progressive resistance. For example, you can start loading them with the kettlebell, ask him to do a single leg deadlift with the kettlebell. You can ask him to do RDL. You can ask him to do a deadlift with the barbell, bench rows, or you can start loading various muscles with resistance. Now coming to the running technique. So running technique has to be corrected, because as I told you, running technique is one of the factor which has to be monitored, so that the recurrence is not there. Previously, he might not be having a proper running technique, but when he's going after the injury, post-injury, he has to, as I told you, he should not come back with the injury. The recurrence should not be there. So that you need to assess every factor and check everything is good. And you need to correct the running technique as well. Just a minute. So this is a familiar running technique, where most of the people will be having a familiar running technique. So where there'll be a very different posture, they'll be following a abnormal posture, where there'll be abnormal load in the different joints. It's like there'll be load in the lower back or the knees and the ankle, this is because of the load distribution. So like there'll be abnormal load distribution in every muscles. For example, in this case, see, the line of gravity passes through the hip flexor and the groin. So if it is not proper, there will be a load, more load at that particular region. So you need to work on that as well. So you need to correct it by you have to correct it to a good running technique. So where there will be less impact on the joints where there will be proper recruitment of the muscles during running, and there will be a proper line of gravity. So that there will be less load of muscles will be there will be less load at the muscles. So for that, what can we do? So as I told you, you can give high knees, which is a running specific training. You can give tuck jumps, and you can give you can ask them to do all those in underwater, like ask them to do for high knees, jogs, sprint in underwater, so that and give them a proper technique, like proper guidance. So you can also be with them when they are initially performing them. Ask them, view the, like just see them how they are performing, and you can also give them a proper advice by you have to instruct them properly if they are not doing it in the right way. So like if he is not, for example, if the hip mobility is less, he will not be able to flex the hip properly, and for that he will be using his ankle to compensate the hip flexion. So there will be a lot of load at the ankle, and the peroneal muscles will be loaded more. So that you need to work on the hip mobility so that his hip flexion range has been maintained. And if he has a, if you see in this position, in this picture, he has an increased lumbar lordosis. So you need to check the pelvic tilt and correct it. And there should be a proper recruitment of the transverse abdominis and the pelvic muscles to maintain the pelvic tilt and reduce the increased lumbar lordosis. And you also have to work on the upper back, so that if he is having any kyphosis, then you need to work on the upper back. Strengthen the upper back muscles, the neck muscles, the whole spinal muscle has to be corrected. Then you have to, then there will be a proper stability from the spine, so that the line of gravity will be better. Same way, if you work on the hip and the spine, most of the problems will be corrected. And you need to show them a proper running technique videos. Like you have to show how the proper running technique is. You need to educate everyone from stage to stage. So if a player comes to you, he has to know what is happening to him. So you have to tell him that this is what happened to you. So there is an inflammatory problem at your at this region. That is why you're having pain. You need to explain him so that he is able to understand what has happened to him. So that he'll have a trust on you. He'll be trusting you, and so that he'll be cooperating with you throughout the course of the injury. So that like he'll be updating you. So if you gain the trust, he'll be calling you, sir. Today it was better, sir. Today I was able to perform these exercises without pain. You have to get the feedback. Same way, you have to get the feedback every. You have to make the feedback documentation with every progression. So you have to get if he is coming back to you with pain, you need to alter it. For example, I showed you a small exercise of for the hip flexors. If he is not able to do properly, if the technique is not right, if the technique is wrong, if he is able to and he is doing with pain, then what you have to do? You just need to see. Ask him to perform in front of you and see how he is performing, and make corrections for that. Even if he is doing the workout with the proper technique and if he is having any pain, then ask him to avoid that exercise, so that you'll be able to give a proper progression. Same way, you need to recruit all the postural muscles. You need to work on all the postural muscles. You need to strengthen the calf and the quads and hip muscles to maintain a proper posture. So by correcting the posture, you can indirectly correct the running posture. So running technique can be analyzed by we can just take a video of it and see if that is an easy procedure. But if you want to go on with an advanced thing, advanced analysis, there is a 3D analysis or video analysis which is actually available in few places in India, where the player or the person will be asked to perform a running or a sport specific activity. For example, if he is a bowler, he'll be asked to bowl. If he is a football player, he'll be asked to perform a running as well as kicking movements in various planes, and then the video will be recorded in various cameras surrounding him. There will be force plates on the ground which will help you to read the ground reaction force. And you can take those guidelines. We can also, there are also various EMG feedbacks that you can get from this analysis, where we can place some markers around on the bony prominence or the particular muscle you are going to analyze, and take a EMG analysis and see how the recruitment of the muscle is. And according to the recruitment of the muscle, you will be able to get a detailed analysis of what is happening and what is happening, why the progression is being delayed. You can have a detailed analysis and you can give a proper routine for them. For example, if this player has been going for a video analysis for delayed progression, and in this video analysis, as I told you, if there is any hip mobility discomfort, if there is a reduced hip mobility, you'll be able to see a proper feedback where you'll be able to see a proper video or motion where you can see more movement happening at the ankle to compensate the hip movement. So you can analyze it easily and prepare a rehab schedule for that. So workload management is one of the major area that you need to work, because workload management, if it is not done properly, you'll obviously come back to you with pain. So how do you manage? So I told you about progressive resistant exercise, right? Resistance should be given progressively. Same way, the workload should be given progressively. As I told you, you need to work on the muscles first, then you need to work on the sport specific activities, then you can go on with the practice session. So for example, if the team is practicing, ask him to continue with the team for the practice sessions. So you can ask him to go on with 50% of effort, 40, for example, you can start off with 30 or 40% of effort. If he's able to complete it, complete the training with 30 or 40% of effort for a long duration, for a perfect time, then we can also, increase the percentage. We can ask them to increase the percentage. But you have to get a proper feedback. You need to teach them what is 50%, what is 40%, what is 30%. You need to teach him how the, what is the percentage. Because if he's able to, if he's going to, for example, if how you can teach, like if he's able to lift 100 kilos for 10 times, that is 100% for him. So we can ask him to go for 100, if it is 50%, we can ask him to go on with 50 kilos. If it is 25%, we can ask him to go on with 25 kilos. Same way, you have to ask him to give the load of the muscle or to perform the movement to make them, make sure that they go not, they don't go beyond that particular percentage. So you need to make them aware of what is happening to them. So the education, or you have to make sure that he is understanding the percentage level, so that you can start progressing slowly. So you can start off with 20, 30, then slowly 40, 50, 60, 70, and then you can ask him to go for 100%. Same way, if he is a fast bowler, you can ask, only you can ask him to go for spot bowling. If he is able to do spot bowling without pain, then you can ask him to go for a normal bowling session. So, for example, previously, if he used to do, if he used to bowl 70% of, sorry, if he is, for example, 50 balls in practice sessions regularly, you can ask him to go for 10 or 15 balls initially. And if he is able, if he is bowling at, for example, if he is a bowler who is bowling at the speed of 130 kilometers per hour, you can ask him to reduce the speed. If he is able to, for example, if he is a sprinter, if he is going to complete 100 meters within, for example, if it is a 15 seconds, if he is able to complete, then you need to ask him to take a prolonged duration. So make him to complete in 20 seconds or 25 seconds. Like that, you can differentiate. So that the workload is being managed, so that the effort of the muscle is less and the load towards the injury is less. So same way he can do. And You have to monitor everything. So like you need to monitor, you need to document it and see how the percentage, how he is reacting to every increase of percentage. So by that way you can increase the load. For example, it is very difficult to do a workload management, but for example, now recently there was a workload management study which was done with the Indian fast bowler Bumrah. They used a software. I'm not clearly aware of that software name of the software. What they did is like they made him wear a chest sensor on the chest, and they made him to, as he was getting a strain on the back frequently, they wanted to make sure that he is able to bowl only for the matches perfectly. So what they did is like they made him wear a chest sensor, and they made him to bowl. So they were able to analyze with the software. They were able to analyze how the percentage of his loading percentage he was loading. So with that percentage, finally with all those findings, they made him to bowl only 8 balls during the training session or the practice session. They made him to bowl only 8 balls, so that his so that the muscle memory is being maintained and his energy is being consumed there, and there will be a less load towards the back, so that he'll be able to perform better. So by that way, this is one high tech way of analyzing the work management, but it is not easily available in market. But you have to make sure. So with this, but without all those gadgets, you need to manage the workload by educating the player. That is the only thing that can be done by us. But there will be minor errors will be happening with that. But we, with the proper feedback and follow-up, we'll be able to correct it. What are the criteria to return to play? So first thing that contributes is there should be no pain. So that is the thing, and he has to play a practice match or a practice sessions without pain. His core strength should be above 4. So these are all one of the, and the pelvic mobility is being maintained properly, and the stability is being maintained properly. His running tracking has to be corrected. So these are all the criteria to go for the return to sport. And all those exercises that we gave for him, so he has to complete it with a proper strength, without any pain. If the strength is being maintained. All the tests that we did previously should be negative. All those, these are also things that we have to take in consideration before you certify him to go back to a sport. So as it is a sports injury, what do you do on field? So how do you manage on field? So for example, if he is a very important player for the match, as I'm more into cricket, let me give an example with cricket as well. Okay. So for example, he is a fast bowler. He is one of the important fast bowler for the team. What do you do on field? So how do you manage? So he's been diagnosed in mid of the tournament. But for example, if it is stage 2 or stage 3, we'll be able to manage to a minimal level. If the symptoms are okay, then we'll be able to manage in a minimal level. But if it is a stage 4, then definitely we'll ask him to go for rest. So the decision, and moreover, as it is a team sport, there will be a lot of superiors for us. So we'll have to report to the coach, the management, and the team captain. If it is a team sport, you need to inform the team captain so that they'll have to prepare for the backup. So what happens if he's a player? So, but the pain is less. If he's able to manage, if you think that he'll be able to manage properly, or you and the player and the team is willing to take risk on the player. As it is, for example, if it is a World Cup final, you cannot ask him to go take rest if he comes in between the game. But you need to make sure that you go back, get back on field and perform. But there'll be a slight differences in the performance, but you need to make sure that you make him to perform at the same level. Okay. So what can be done? You can like taping. So, and hip spike can be done, and there are various compression thigh compression sleeves are available at the market, so you can use all those things. But you can also use taping techniques to. So if I'm going to tape, I'll be taping the abdominals and the hip flexor and the groin, and I'll be supporting with hip spike. Okay, and no other option, we'll be giving some painkillers for them to that particular player to maintain, to reduce the pain, so that he'll be able to perform during the tournament. If possible, you can ask him to come in between and take some therapy, like manual release, or you can actually just take a bit of a rest, and then he can go inside. If it is a test match, you'll be having a plenty of time. You can make him come inside and go out. But that can be done only if it is an on-field injury. If it is an off-field injury, it is pretty difficult. It is little difficult for him to come inside and go. If it happens in the first match, we'll be having a leverage of asking him to come and go in between any time. But if it is if the symptoms is persisting, and if he has to perform for the second match, he'll not be given that amount of time. He'll be made to come back immediately. So we'll be given only a few minutes of time to get back onto the road. So we have to prepare them according to the game. So the major thing that we can give is a cryo compression. This is one equipment called Game Ready, where you can use good equipment for cryo compression. This actually gives a very good result. I have been using one of the technique of cryo compression, which actually gives a very good result during the match. I can make him to go for 2-3 minutes. I can apply it on him, and he gets back to the ground. We can also do that. So these are all the things that I wanted to tell you about. Any questions, please, sir? I'm done, sir.
Yes, sir. It was a wonderful session. We have a few questions, I guess.
Yes, please.
Rupesh, read it, Rupesh.
Yes, sir.
Participants can post their questions in chat box.
Ma'am?
Participants are requested to post their questions in chat box.
Yeah.
I was disconnected. I don't see any chat questions.
Any questions, dear participants?
Find any question.
Yeah.
Participants, you are requested to post your questions in chat box, please.
Okay, I think there is no doubt. I think Vairav clearly explained everything. Oh, there is a doubt.
Yes, sir. Yeah. First one is from Mr. Jitender.
Oh.
Sir, is there any evidence that taping helps in osteitis pubis?
So, as I told you, it is just a conservative management. It is not the thing that it helps in recovery, but it is just a supportive thing that can be done. As I told you, I'll be giving the tape to support the muscle a little bit, but I'll be using the hip spike or the compression sleeve to give a better result. But taping is it doesn't give much of a difference.
Fine. The next one is from Dr. Logeshwari, ma'am. It was nice and informative session.
Thank you.
Next one is from Mr. Rasu. How to use ultrasound therapy and position, sir?
So ultrasound therapy, we can give it in supine lying, but mostly we don't use ultrasound therapy because it is an inflammatory condition. We can apply it in supine lying motion.
Yes, sir. Fine, sir. Next is from Ms. Anisha. Thank you, sir. It was a wonderful session.
Rupesh, sorry to interrupt you. Suresh Jodi, sir, was raising his hand.
Sir, I was unmuting him. Sir, you want to... Suresh Jyoti, sir.
Okay.
Sir, you want to unmute, sir? Suresh, sir.
Thank you. Rupesh, it's a good presentation. I have a few doubts regarding this HostGTQ base. You had talked about overall management of HostGTQ base, no? But specifically, these conditions is more common in runners as well as jumpers type of sports activities.
Yes, sir.
Yes. So yes, you had talked about the managements, heavy load managements, etc., etc. In what way this management is going to be help you out, the participants who is participating in running type of an activities? Because
so I told you,
aerobic activities rather than in that particularly, I'm not saying strength is not much important, but strength is also strategy here. So in what way it's going to help you out this type of an exercise program for runners, I mean athlete people?
Sir, as I told you, sir, there are it is an repetitive stress or caused due to muscle imbalance. Okay. So if you correct the muscles and if you align the posture perfectly, and if the balance and the load has been given to the proper muscles by strengthening it properly, then definitely there is going to be a less load happening to that point, so that it will improve automatically, no, sir.
Okay. And I have one more doubt. What are the precautionary measures should go during this heavy load management protocol? Because this osteitis pubis, it's as you said, it's inflammations of pubic symphysis, and it is a component which will be holding on abdominal organs. They are more prone for a hernia type of a complication.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes. So what are the precautionary measures should take before going this heavy load management or any sponsoring protocol, as you have said in this webinar sessions?
Sir, the precautions is like you have to see whether he's been his posture and his muscle. Basically, we need to start with pain, sir, and the assessment. You need to be precise if that there is no hernia or any organs involved in this injury. So with that assessment, you'll be able to assess on the first point. When it is coming to the precautions, you need to make sure that any activity that is increasing the pain has to be avoided. For example, as I said, if the running is causing the pain, you need to avoid running. So by that way, these are the basic thing is like you should not allow the pain to increase. That is so any activity that causing the pain should be avoided, sir. That is the only major precaution that can be maintained, sir.
Okay. Okay, that is about to aggravate the pain. This scenario, that precautionary for any other particular precautionary measures is available to prevent hernia type of complications.
So, if you strengthen the abdominal wall properly, then hernia has been sports hernia can be avoided, sir.
Yes, of course. Then you are meaning that the core strengthening also has to be incorporated.
Yes. Yes, sir.
Yes. Okay. Yes, and someone, I want to add one more point, if you don't mind.
Please, sir.
Someone has been asked about this ultrasound management, how to give one. So, right, it's mainly the rectus abdominis muscle is going for problematic with this osteotic view basis with your adductors of your thigh, I mean hip, right? So, you can go for ultrasound management over in rectus abdominis muscles. It is not going to be directly work on your pubic symphysis, but anyway, it's helpful to heal the rectus abdominal muscles, which is having major role in this osteotic pubis, right?
Yes.
And so, as per answers which is given by the Vaidav, it has to be given in a supine lying. We can't go on any other lying management, but rather than giving this ultrasonic management, you can go about a cryotherapy. It is going to be help you out much in osteotic pubis, right? And thank you, Vaidav. It is a wonderful presentation.
Thank you so much, sir.
And thank you, Chandramohan sir and Rupesh. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much for adding valuable points to the session.
Yes, sir. Next is from Ms. Virali Shah. Sir, can a swimmer resume breaststroke from a swimming post recovery of osteitis pubis?
Swimmers, I don't think I have not seen anyone having osteitis pubis. So I'm not able to answer this question. Sorry.
Fine, yes, sir. Next is from Ms. Monica. Sir, what are the other indications for Copenhagen adductor exercise other than osteitis pubis?
Sorry, I'm not able to get you.
Copenhagen, 1 second, sir, I will unmute her.
Copenhagen exercise, adductor exercise.
Open. Monica MP, ma'am, you can unmute and you can ask your question, please.
That Vairava taught Copenhagen adductor exercises.
Yes, sir, that was my question. What are the other indications than osteitis pubis we can give the Copenhagen exercise? Because it was new to me, so that I can research more for that. That's why I'm asking.
Sure,
what are the indications and contraindications for that particular exercises that was too new for me?
The basic indication is like you can, if you want to work on the hip mobility, you can start with that. You know? So that is one major indication. As I told you, as we discussed, osteitis pubis. If you want to strengthen your like work on your pelvis, you can start with that. So if majorly we concentrate that on sports activities. You know? Contraindication, I can tell you that if there is any muscle imbalance, if the posture is not good, if he has any SI joint dysfunction which is not being treated properly, in that case you need to strengthen and align the SI joint properly, then you'll be able to do properly. And major thing is like you need to have the proper strength of the postural muscles such as external oblique, internal oblique, all these muscles has to be made, like the strength has to be proper. So the that particular position, starting position, is if he is able to maintain, then we can go on with it. So it is not only that we can give the exercises only for sports players, but if any client who is coming to you with the core, looking forward to improve the core, we can give them one. So that all the factors surrounding, all the muscles surrounding the core and the pelvis will be stabilized.
Fine, sir. Monica, ma'am, is that fine?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you for that. And one more doubt I'm having.
Yes, ma'am, please.
Yeah, the running technique correction you have mentioned that, sir.
Yes, ma'am.
If the runner is already having the familiar running pattern, how can we change the good running pattern, sir?
So, as I told you, please complete your question.
They have been practicing that for years, no, sir. Then how can we practice them in a way to a good running pattern, sir?
So it is not a change that we can get it in overnight, ma'am. So it is going to take a very long time. So this technique correction has to be done only during off-season, ma'am. So as this is a prolonged condition, if the OS is, as I told you, it is going to take at least a year or so, so that we can include it in his protocol. But if a normal player who doesn't have an injury, if he is perfect, but he is willing to improve his performance, in that scenario, you need to work on the off-season training. You need to work on that factor during the off-season, because the training that you're going to give, for example, if you need to analyze, you are taking a video. As I told you, you need to take a video of him running. So, and see how he is running. So, same way, as I told you, if the posture is like, if there is an increased lordosis, or if his hip mobility is less, so that he is compensating on his with his ankle. Like that, you need to make sure, and you need to draw imaginary lines in every towards every joint and see the how the angle goes on, and just draw a center of gravity line and see where the base of support is, and if everything goes well, then he is having a good technique. Then if you want to correct it, you need to see the surrounding factors which is affecting it. For example, if his pelvic tilt is abnormal, so that his lordosis is increased, so that you need to correct the pelvic tilt. So you work on the core and the glute. And for example, as I told you, if he's having less hip mobility, then improve on his hip mobility. Then go on with drills such as high knees and tuck jumps. Like that, there are various drills to improve the improve that specific movement. So that we can go on that. But basic thing and important thing is like if he is a fit player who wants to improve his running technique, This can be done only during off season. But this might take a long time, because it might take 3 months for a player. It might take 4 or 5 months for a player, depending upon the changes that we require for that player. Is it clear, ma'am?
1 second, sir. Fine, Ms. Monica.
Thank you, sir, for the correct answer. That was the answer I was expecting. That normal player, I was expecting the duration for the normal player and also Australian previous player. So, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Fine, sir. Next one is from Ms. Sweta. Sir, will Australian previous affect the speed of bowling in cricket players? Sir?
Definitely. If there is a pain during running, definitely it is going to affect. There will be a small biomechanical changes as well, because to compensate his pain, he'll be changing his bowling action or his foot placement, so that he'll definitely, there will be a abnormal load. Definitely it will affect his bowling.
Yes, sir. Fine. The next one is from Mr. Jitender. Sir, can reverse clamshell exercise be done in these conditions?
Yes, definitely.
Yes, sir. Mr. Kiran, sir, please explain DIP, dip test.
Dip test, want to
screen share, sir, you can.
Screen share, pardon.
Your wish, sir.
Screen share is allowed, sir.
Are you able to?
Screen share is allowed, sir. Please share your screen. It's visible, sir.
Yeah. So, dip test is... dip test is single leg squat with... you need to ask him to place the back foot on a stool and ask him to go for a dip in this position. Dip is like just sitting and standing with similar to a single leg squat. So, as I told you need to analyze the movement, weight distribution, pelvic and the lumbar alignment and the leg alignment and the foot alignment. So if it is good, everything will be smooth and you'll be able to manage the weight load properly. If it is abnormal, there will be a different workload, weight management. You'll be using a compensatory movement for every rep that is been doing. So this is how we do a dip test. Okay, sir.
Rupesh, you can unmute the person and ask where exactly he needs a clarification.
Fine, sir. Mr. Kiran is not in the list, sir. I guess he left.
He left. Okay.
Fine, sir. Next one is from Mr. Suresh Balaraman. Excellent presentation. Precise to it. Great work, sir.
Thank you so much.
Next is from Ms. Supraja. Difference between osteitis pubis and athletic pubalgia, sir. Are they similar and do the treatment varies?
So, the athletic pubalgia and this one is totally different. But the thing is, this is an inflammatory condition, but it is going to take, it is more of a bony region where it is going to take a prolonged duration to recovery. But exercise program, as I told you, it depends upon it. It will vary a bit. So you need to work on that specific muscle group that is being involved.
Fine, sir. Next is again from Mr. Suresh Balaram. In extreme condition, surgery needed for this condition?
Yeah, surgery is needed, but I didn't want to explain much about surgery.
Fine, sir. Next is from our Karthik Dasan, sir. Do we have any standardized return to play testing for this condition?
So as of now, the workload management is the only thing, and muscle strength will be assessed, and according to the muscle strength and the pain criteria, we'll be able to go on. So as I told you, the progressive workload management and analyzing the way how he is progressing, according to that, and if he is able to complete the exercises perfectly without any pain and assessing the muscle strength and the mobility, we can give him a fit to play criteria, sir.
Fine, sir. Next one is from Mr. Vail. Do osteitis pubis disturb weight training like snatch, clean, and jerk and squats?
Definitely, definitely.
Yes, sir.
As he's be having pain during that movement, initially it will be there. If you correct the imbalance and if you have the proper muscle strength to work on it, then slowly you can, as I told you, during the progressive resisted exercises, that resistance will help. Like you will be giving them a resisted exercise. But if he is able to do in that particular stage, if he is pain-free to do all those set of exercises, then during that time, it will be better, sir. If he is having pain or something like that, definitely it is going to affect.
Fine, sir. Next one is from Mr. Jitender. Sir, CT and MRI confirm the diagnosis or are they just suggestive and bone scan is required for confirmation?
So, it depends upon the need. If it has been confirmed with CT and MRI, then not required. If the bone scan is required, if he is not able, if he is not able to find out properly in CT or MRI, then we can go on with the bone scan.
Fine, sir. And few appreciations, thank you messages. Any more questions?
You can take out the screen share now. Stop screen sharing.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Yes, sir. Any other questions, participants? Okay, I think we can conclude it.
Nepsiba, any questions?
Anybody raising hands? Satyaraja. Unmute.
Shabila.
Satyaraja is raising hand actually.
Yes, sir. Shabila also.
Yeah, one by one.
Yeah. Satyaraj, you can unmute.
Satyaraja, sorry by mistake.
By mistake. Sir, Karthik Dasan, sir, wants to speak. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir, you can unmute.
Yeah. Hi, Vera. That was a wonderful presentation. So, speaking about this RTP, return to play protocol, I told there is no standardized RTP protocol. So you were mentioning about the player who will be injured on field and you'll be if in this case of like final match or something. So how the decision will be made? Like, do you mean to say like the RTP will be like it is only of subjective thing or if you don't have any standardized thing, how can we come to that decision? Like we can.
So, as I told you, sir, it is a risk that we are going to take. And moreover, it is a team sport, so that we'll have to consider consider if the player is willing to continue or the team is required, then he has to play. All these things also, and the need of the captain and the team will also be taken into consideration. If it is a worst case scenario, then we'll have to make him sit. If he is able to manage for a limit with pain medications and other things, then we can make him to go on with it. With the support of tape and hip spica, if he is comfortable, then we can make him to go back, sir.
Okay, fine. Okay, sound convincing. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Mr. Suresh Balaram, sir. You can speak up.
Sir, good presentation, sir. Vairav, sir.
Thank you.
Good
sir,
and
sir.
Excellent, precise presentation.
My only
doubt is why the inflection reduced range will be overacting of the peroneus will be affected.
Sorry, sir, I'm not able to hear you. Your voice is little low.
If it is.
Sorry, sir.
Why reduced efflection range will affect the peroneus group, sir?
If he is not able to flex the... Yeah, so it is a thing that if he is not able to flex the hip properly, the knee range of motion will be affected, right? So he has to compensate his ankle. Like ankle dorsiflexion, plantar flexion will happen more in that scenario, sir, to compensate it. So... what happens is because of the less knee flexion, he will be having more contact of the foot. Because of that, the peroneus will be loading more, sir. There will be more action of ankle movement, that will be causing the overactivity of peroneal, sir.
Most commonly, the peroneal is only affected, sir, in ankle.
Because the shin muscles will be more affected, sir. As of I've seen, like that hip mobility. If the hip mobility is less, there are more prone to get shin splints, sir.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Yes,
sir. One more question from Sabila, sir. Ms. Sabila.
Yes,
sir. How to measure the amount of workload of muscles, like 50% or 70% muscle load?
So as I told you, it is between how you teach the player. Because if, as I told you, the timing can be one of the factor that we can take into consideration. Then the workload that you, the weights that is being given, the speed that is being running, the effort that is being putting, that is being using. You can use, for example, if he is exerting too much, then you can use RPE scale, rate of perceived exertion scale, to clinically measure. That is the only way that we can clinically measure workload management.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Any more questions, sir, participants?
Shall we conclude?
Hope so, sir.
Yes, thank you, Dr. Vairav Sudarshan, for a wonderful session. And
thank
we
you,
are happy
so
to have you again as a resource person in our EXRS webinar Super League.
It's my pleasure.
World record. Yeah, welcome. You're always welcome. You are also one among us. So
yes,
we are happy to have you. I thank all the participants and fitness and the Rehab India YouTube channel subscribers for giving us support and being patiently till the end of the session and the cooperation. And thanks, Dr. Vairav, for answering all the questions.
Thank you
so much,
sir.
I thank volunteer and Dr. Supraja and Dr. Rupesh and Professor Duna Saha for their help to run the session very smoothly. And I thank everyone. Good night to all of you. See you tomorrow.
Good night,
sir. Thank you.
Good night.
Good night.
Yeah. Bye-bye.